Hello and welcome. This is the Dechert for Real podcast, where we discuss current issues and trends for commercial real estate finance. We aim to bring market commentary about developments, updates you can use, and hopefully a little bit of banter along the way. I'm Jon Gaynor, a counsel based in Dechert's Philadelphia office.
I'm Ella Smith, a partner based in Dechert's Charlotte office.
And I'm Sam Gilbert, a partner based up in Dechert's Boston office.
Today, Ella, Sam, and I will be discussing our forecast for the next year in a segment we're calling Forward Legal Thinking.
We really do love our fours here, don't we, John?
You got to work your theme, Sam. In that, we'll delve into trends in the market and changes to rules and regulations that we expect to drive industry developments in 2024. Before that, in our 411 segment, where we talk about issues percolating in the market, you'll hear about the SEC's recently adopted Rule 192 with special guest John Ludwig-Eagan, the SEC providing relief under public disclosure requirements of Rule 15C211 for Rule 144A fixed income securities, and the auction of Signature Bank's commercial real estate portfolio. But first, let's get for real with the hosts to warm things up. We're into December now and well into the holiday season with all the good cheer and merriment that brings. So that takes me to our for real this month. What is your favorite holiday tradition? Ella, why don't you go first?
So I know I talk a lot about Cayman's issues on this podcast. However, my favorite holiday tradition is actually related. So my family and I, every year, the week leading up to Christmas, go on a Caribbean cruise. I know it's like not traditional, but I do love a white Christmas. I just prefer the white sand beaches of Jamaica. And in theory, I mean, I do like the idea of sitting by a fire with hot cocoa, but like in reality, I'll be drinking a piña colada on the pool deck of a giant cruise ship. So I hope you guys enjoy your Northeast Christmas with lots of cold and blustery snow, but I will definitely be out in the blue seas of the Caribbean.
That does sound amazing. My tradition's probably a little more traditional. My family celebrates both Hanukkah and Christmas, but I grew up celebrating Christmas, and I've always loved putting up the Christmas tree. I especially love that cozy feeling when the lights are down low in the house and you're sitting around with friends and family with a warm drink like, you know, a hot chocolate, or, you know, you could convince me to have some mulled wine, but you're in the soft glow of the tree, and there's really nothing quite like that for me.
And I'll piggyback on that one a little bit, John, and say that my favorite tradition, I think, is going out and cutting down that Christmas tree. I think it's my favorite tradition, but also probably my least favorite tradition. I love getting out there with the family and walking through the farm in the cold weather that Ella hates, and looking for the right tree. But it's also probably the most stressful hour of the year, trying to decide between the trees, and I think leads to probably the most arguing between our family all year, because we can't agree on a tree and we can't have five separate trees. So, but I do love it because it kind of marks the official start of the season for me. So it's something I really look forward to. That and, of course, the 24-hour Christmas Story marathon on TV on Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. So
it's funny, the radios in Philly, there's a radio station that's 24 hours a day Christmas music. And that started like the day after Thanksgiving, which is wild to me.
Those songs would be so much better if played on steel drums, I just have to say.
Really good point. And I think that counts as getting for real for this month. So that takes us to our 411s. So first, let's introduce our special guest this week to help give the 411s, John Ludwig-Eagan, who is an associate based out of Dechert's New York office. John, when you were on For Real podcast 2 months ago to discuss the SEC's proposed Rule 192, you agreed to come back and give us an update when they adopted the final Rule 192. I didn't expect you'd be back on so soon, but here we are.
It caught me by surprise too, but I'm glad to be back.
Now, before we dive into the substance, since you are a kind of a guest here again, we've got to get for real with you. So any favorite holiday traditions for you?
So nothing holiday specific. Unlike Ella, I really like the snow. So whenever we get our first snow of the season, we start up the fireplace, just kind of have a nice low-key cozy night in.
That sounds super nice. I'm very down with the cozy during the winter time. So tell us about the final Rule 192.
Sure. So the final rule came out in late November, and it's materially narrower and clearer than what was proposed. So much so that it really caught me by surprise. But the overall contours are the same. If you're a securitization participant, you're prohibited from entering into a conflicted transaction with respect to an asset-backed security unless you can show that the transaction fits into one of three exceptions. And those are for permitted risk mitigating hedging activity, transactions in support of liquidity commitments, and bona fide market making activities. So here's a few important things the SEC changed in the final rule. First major point is the definition of conflicted transaction. And this is the catch-all third prong that people were worried would capture all sorts of things that are innocuous and routine. The SEC replaced this with a new prong three that says it's a conflicted transaction if it is, quote, substantially the economic equivalent of a short sale or credit default swap or credit derivative. And here the SEC really picked up on the thrust of what a lot of people were saying here, which is essentially that what the SEC proposed went very far beyond the type of transactions that would constitute a bet against a securitization. Importantly, they also made clear in the rule itself that interest rate and currency hedging are fine. One thing people were very concerned about in the comments was CRT deals, which banks and GSEs use to manage credit risk for purposes of regulatory capital.
And what does CRT stand for?
Credit risk transfer. The release made clear that the SEC consider those credit risk transfer deals to be conflicted transactions. And so any credit risk transfer deal would need to constitute permissible risk mitigating hedging. But that's a requirement that's now a lot easier for these deals to satisfy because the SEC removed the language in the hedging exception that said the initial issuance of an ABS wouldn't qualify. Second major point is the multi-part definition of sponsor. So sponsors are one class of securitization participants that are subject to the rule. They kept the prong that says you're a sponsor if you're a sponsor under Regulation AB. And they kept the part that says you're a sponsor if you have the contractual right to direct or cause the direction of the structure, design, or assembly of the asset-backed security or the asset pool. And this is the so-called contractual right sponsor prong. But they got rid of the so-called directing sponsor prong that would have said you're a sponsor if you actually direct or cause the direction of the structure or the underlying pool, regardless of whether or not you have a contractual right to do so. They also made clear that if you're acting solely pursuant to your rights as a long investor, you're scoped out. But the SEC hedged a little bit with B-piece buyers specifically and said it will come down to whether they're acting solely in connection with their long position. And they also removed the GSE exemption. In the proposal, Fannie and Freddie would not have been considered sponsors while they're in conservatorship, but the final rule eliminates that exemption. Makes it clear that the SEC intends that the GSEs be subject to the same rules as any other market participant. The third major point, affiliates and subsidiaries. The original proposal said that if you're a sponsor, underwriter, initial purchaser, or placement agent, you're a securitization participant, and all of your affiliates and subsidiaries are too. The final rule scales this back quite a bit, and it says that an affiliate or subsidiary is only subject to the rule if it acts in coordination with someone who's already a securitization participant or has access to information about the asset-backed security or the asset pool before the deal closes. So the rule becomes effective 60 days after it's published in the Federal Register. It hasn't been published yet, but it should be soon, and it will apply to any ABS that closes 18 months or after that publication date. But it's important to point out that people will become subject to the rule once they reach an agreement to become a securitization participant. And that happens before the securitization closes. So folks should expect to have a compliance plan in place well before that 18-month window closes. There's a whole lot of other things to talk about in the final rule, but there's only so much time in the day. So if you're interested in learning more, be on the lookout for a forthcoming Dechert On Point, where we will talk about the final rule in a little more detail.
Thanks for sharing all that, John, and we really appreciate having you. If you're interested in reading the On Point, it should be in our show notes. So thanks again for joining us, John. We really appreciate your time. I'm up next with Rule 15c2-11. In 2021, the SEC took the position that fixed income securities, including asset-backed securities, fall within the scope of Rule 15c2-11 under the Exchange Act. Now, you might ask yourself, what is an asset-backed security? For purposes of the listenership of this podcast, that includes most of the mortgage-backed securities and the CMBS that you would buy out and around the world. Previously, this rule was only applicable to equity securities. And the effect of the interpretation that the SEC put out was that broker-dealers couldn't quote fixed income securities in any quotation medium without first determining that the issuer had made certain information about those securities publicly available. The SEC staff extended the compliance deadline several times in response to concerns raised by trade groups, law firms, and other industry participants, but they were silent on whether any permanent relief would be forthcoming. Then, on October 30, 2023, after continued pressure from legislators and industry participants, and a recent lawsuit filed by the National Association of Manufacturers and Kentucky Association of Manufacturers against the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission and Gary Gensler, the SEC issued an order providing relief for fixed income securities sold pursuant to Rule 144A. The SEC didn't initiate a rulemaking process, but instead exercised its exemptive authority to provide relief. The exemptive order stated that a broker or dealer is exempt from the requirements of Rule 15c2-11 with respect to a fixed income security to be sold in compliance with the safe harbor in Rule 144A under the Securities Act of 1933. The practical effect of this is that the SEC's Rule 15c2-11 exemptive order provides welcome relief to market participants that issue Rule 144A fixed income securities, which includes most privately offered commercial mortgage-backed and CRE CLO securities. Brokers will now be able to provide quotes on Rule 144A fixed income securities without having to determine if the issuers have made that certain information publicly available to investors.
So, John, it really seems like the SEC used common sense, because Rule 144A securities can only be sold to qualified institutional buyers, and those QIBs already have access to similar information through investor websites. And requiring issuers to make such information publicly available to all investors wouldn't really have made much sense, because the general public, like my mom, hi, Mom, can't purchase Rule 144A securities anyway.
I'm kind of surprised your mom isn't a quib, but we can get into that later, Ella.
Oh, my mom is definitely not a quib. Okay, Sam, tell us what's going on with the auction of Signature Bank's commercial real estate portfolio.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Ella. So a recent, you know, market event that's been keeping us busy here at Dechert is the FDIC's auction of Signature Bank's commercial real estate loan portfolio. I mean, I'm sure everyone is sort of aware of the backstory with Signature Bank. And back in September, the FDIC announced the start of a marketing process for what was a $33 billion commercial real estate loan portfolio that was in receivership. Marketing that portfolio took place over the past few weeks. A bunch of industry participants were scrambling to do their diligence and put together bids and bidding groups, with the winning bids reportedly being awarded around Thanksgiving, and all these closings expected to be completed by year-end 2023. The identity of these winning bidders is still not public, although there's been a lot of reporting around it. There are some listeners out there who are still working through the actual acquisition portion of the process, but it'll certainly be interesting to see at the end of this month where all these loans are going, how they're being financed, et cetera, when things start closing later this month. You know, I mentioned here at Dechert, we played a pretty active role in the bidding and financing process for a number of clients. Having been involved in one of them, I can tell you it was a very fast-paced process with a lot of twists and turns, trying to structure a deal that would work for everyone. And it'll certainly be interesting to see how the market digests this $33 billion worth of loans. You know, could it lead to lower prices for CRE properties? With these purchasers getting these loans from the receivership at a discount, they may be willing to sell them for less than par or accept discounted payoffs. You know, and if anything, this huge sale, I mean, it's the largest commercial property sale this year, I believe, when it all closes, is going to provide the market with some data points on where values are and how much they may have fallen, and some data points that people really have been looking for recently. You know, and the other thing I'm thinking of is, will we finally see some non-performing loan securitizations. My understanding is a lot of these Signature Bank assets were performing, but it certainly included a number of non-performing ones. And obviously, we'll start to see the percentage of non-performing loans increase elsewhere, separate from Signature Bank. So these type of non-performing loan securitization transactions have been discussed at CREFC for the last few years, but we haven't really seen them yet. So my guess is that some of these loans and some other loans may end up in some of these non-performing loan securitizations like we did see after the GFC back in 2008. So it'll be interesting to see how this all shakes out and what knock-on effects it has on the industry.
I think we've had our non-performing loan securitization papers dusted off for the last 2 years, just waiting for one of these to come up. So I'm really looking forward to when we can help people close some of those deals and hopefully in the near future. But Sam, that was great. Thank you for it. We're on to our next segment. So today, instead of welcoming a guest to the podcast like we normally do, Ella, Sam, and I will be discussing our legal predictions for the next year in a segment we're calling Forward Legal Thinking. Today, we'll discuss some trends in the legal market that we think are going to be driving the conversation in 2024. Let's get started.
2024. I see what you did there, John. Nice.
That one's not a theme joke. That is just actually the inevitable march of time, Sam.
Oh, thank you, John. So my prediction for 2024 is that we'll see CRE CLOs perform well, even in a rocky market for commercial real estate, just because of the inherent flexibility and active management capabilities of this product. In particular, I think we'll see issuers using the technology that allows them to remove a credit-impaired or defaulted loan from the collateral pool, and also the ability for underlying loan modifications on performing assets. What can and can't be modified in a CLO is a really popular question from our clients and other market participants right now. So to give a short answer to that question, CRE CLO modifications typically fall into three buckets. The first category is something we call servicing standard modifications, and they're modifications that the special servicer can perform as long as they meet the servicing standard. They would include major decisions as well. And in major decisions, there's additional hurdles to meet above and beyond meeting just the servicing standard. General standard, it would fall in this bucket. There are two other types of mods available in CRE CLOs as well, which are both directed by the collateral manager and do not need to meet the servicing standard. But in most deals, they can't be performed on assets that are either defaulted or at imminent risk for default. The first of these are administrative modifications, which generally include but are not limited to changes in the benchmark rate, as well as modifications to certain financial covenants related to debt yield and DSCR, certain fee waivers, reserve account balances, or short-term interest rate cap agreement waivers.
Note to the audience, Ella had to repeat administrative modifications several times because she always wanted to say admin mods, which is how we talk about it always.
Administrative is way too long. I want to call them admin mods. And then the CBMs, as I would call them, but for the purpose of the podcast, criteria-based modifications, which are more substantive in nature and typically include extensions of the maturity date, an increase in loan proceeds, a reduction in spread, or the allowance for mezzanine or subordinate debt. There are usually a limited number of allowed criteria-based mods in a deal, and there are a great deal of hurdles to meet before you can actually go through and perform a CBM. So when interest rates were lower and the commercial real estate loan market was doing well, we tended to see a lot of administrative and criteria-based modifications. Now that there's more distress in the market, we're seeing more servicing standard modifications.
So, Ella, have these modification provisions been enough to keep the loans performing and remaining in deals?
Well, John, so far we've found that the modifications have been working, and I think they will continue to be a useful tool in this high interest rate environment. I expect we'll see more modifications of the underlying loans in 2024 as long as interest rates remain higher for longer, because high interest rates can affect the financial covenants for extensions, make it difficult for borrowers to refinance their loans at maturity, and just really cause general distress that can make other modifications attractive, like reallocating interest reserves to cover debt service or lowering the spreads that were set up when we were in a really different interest rate environment. But if modifications aren't a viable option and the loan is at imminent risk for default, CRE CLOs can allow sponsors to buy loans right out of the pool, so a defaulting loan will not put a drag on the investment.
But these CRE CLOs, they aren't perfect, right? I mean, I assume investors are going to start to see losses when loans go REO inside of a deal, right?
I mean, at some point, sponsors may stop buying defaulted and credit risk loans out of CRE CLOs, and we may start seeing more loans being worked out inside the deal. In fact, we may be seeing the first stages of this, as the Commercial Mortgage Alert recently reported that CRE CLO special servicing rates have been ticking sharply upwards during the past month. That being said, CRE CLOs contain many investor-friendly protections that will hopefully make it unlikely that investors will suffer losses. For example, in most CRE CLO structures, the sponsor retains the bottom 15 to 18% of the transaction, which means that any losses will hit the sponsor first and not the offered notes. They also have note protection tests that, if triggered, will divert interest payable on the sponsor's retained notes to pay down the offered notes until a note protection test is satisfied. So even if we start seeing more distressed and defaulted loans in a CRE CLO, I think it'll be a while before that would actually have a material impact on the value of offered notes.
Got it. Thanks, Ella. Yeah, it seems like there's a lot of cushion in there to protect the investors in that structure, which I think is why people look to it. I'll go ahead with my prediction. It's going to be a bit of a reversal for me and for my thinking recently, but it's about the future of interest rates, which I know is a hot topic. But you know, over the last 6 months or so, I've been leaning more and more towards team higher for longer with the assumption that we'd be in the current range of rates for another year or more. But more recently, I'm sort of starting to come around to a view that maybe we'll start to get some relief next year and some real relief, and maybe we'll see some lower rates as we get to the end of 24. Certainly not anywhere close to the near zero rates that we all enjoy thinking, kind of clouding my thoughts here. But, you know, there has been some Fed speak recently that hints towards cuts soon. And, you know, the news recently is that there's now a 52% chance of a quarter point cut in May, however they come up with that. You know, and people are looking for four cuts by the end of 2024. So that, coupled with some encouraging data on inflation getting back to target and job numbers, and you know, hopefully we can line up with the elusive soft landing that people have been talking about. So maybe, just maybe, we'll start to see some real relief next year. That all said, I, of course, reserve the right to change my prediction the next time Powell or another Fed official speaks, or when we get the next jobs report, or, you know, even prior to this episode dropping. But for now, I think I've gotten off the higher for longer train and am looking forward to some real reductions next year.
I feel like the mantra for everyone has got to be don't fight the Fed, which, you know, so many of the predictions before were kind of divorced from the actual words coming out of the Fed at these meetings. And but I can see where you're coming from on this one totally, Sam.
I agree with you. A lot of times people would make the sort of fight the Fed prediction, right? And then the Fed would say something completely opposite and they would just contradict it, I think, because maybe it was the wishful thinking, but we shall see. This isn't being recorded, right? We're not going to be able to check this at the end of 2024. With that, John, that segue, I'll let you make your prediction on tape here.
All right, fine. That's a fair trade. So my prediction is that we're going to see a lot more ESG-related changes and focus in the market in 2024. ESG stands for Environment, Social, and Governance. And I think there's just a lot of things that are queued up to happen and a lot of developments that are going to continue to occur. Chief among them is the SEC's proposed greenhouse gas disclosure rules. These were supposed to drop at some point during Q4 of this year. As of this recording, we have not yet seen them. They could show up anytime over the next 12 months, probably before the end of December. The thing about this rule is that even if you aren't directly affected by this rule, even if you aren't someone who is a target of the rule, it's going to change the environment a little bit. And I mean the situation among your investors, your stakeholders, your counterparties, your borrowers, and everyone else, not, you know, the atmosphere that may or may not be filling up with greenhouse gas. The point is that this ESG stuff is not at all political. It will have practical things that you will have to do in order to make sure that you're in a good position to meet the needs and demands of your stakeholders. You're going to need to be in a good position to collect data, to make sure that the data is accurate, that you're able to report on it, that you have the right scope of the right information. You might have to hire new service providers. You might have to pay accountants to check these things. The kinds of reporting that you do may subject you or your senior leadership to liability. And you want to make sure you have a handle around all of this. And you may directly have to comply with whatever's in the SEC's final rule. But even if not, investors and other stakeholders are going to start asking about it. And maybe the lawyers will get paid a little bit along the way too, I guess. The point is that the systems and processes that you need to have in place to make this work need to be acted on sooner rather than later. The other thing to think about it is that you might not have the right to collect on this information with your underlying obligors. Loan agreements say they have to comply with the law. They don't say they have to give their utilities bills to you usually. They don't have to say that they have to give emissions data to you. So you'll have to either add that right or find another way inside of the covenants in your documents to get that right. Leases that are signed at big commercial properties don't necessarily have these rights either. So if you are a lender and you have a borrower with tenants, you need to figure out a way to make sure that borrower gets the right to get this data from your tenants. The SEC's rule is just one part of a larger framework that keeps falling into place. In Europe, there are already greenhouse gas disclosure rules and requirements and plans. In states like California, which recently passed a massive greenhouse gas disclosure law, there's already obligations that are coming online in 2026 and 2027. And those might not be subject to the same kind of legal challenges that might face the SEC's greenhouse gas rule. So a lot of big companies are going to be in compliance and are going to be working to comply with these rules anyway, which further increases the pressure in and around the environment. Apart from those, though, there are a number of local laws that are in effect or coming into effect in the next couple of years. We get a lot of attention on Local Law 97 in New York City, but at least 40 other cities and states have these local laws already, which, by the way, we did an analysis of these. We basically picked every city that had a football team and analyzed the in effect disclosure rules and greenhouse gas related reduction rules that exist. And if you want that information, reach out to the Dechert team. We're more than happy to provide it. But the point is, there is a broader framework of these disclosure elements that are continuing to be a big deal. This is going to be hitting your desks and wallets in another way too, insurance. So insurance costs and issues around availability have been a big problem in this past year and will continue to be something that people think about in the coming year. Many states that are desirable because of population shifts over time or because of regulatory environments that are more favorable to business are the very ones that are facing the same kind of increased insurance costs due to disproportionate impact of climate change related risks related to weather or flooding or wildfires or hurricanes. And those sorts of impacts are making insurance either more expensive or unavailable. And figuring out how to deal with insurance is another thing that people are going to need to figure out if they want to get deals done in 2024. There have also been some problematic developments in Florida related to PACE loans. Certain counties in Florida have been refusing to collect their PACE assessments, which makes it difficult for lenders to get paid for these PACE assessments or to foreclose on any unpaid PACE assessments. So if this trend spreads, it could potentially have a chilling effect on PACE lending, at least in Florida. Last but not least, even if you don't think this immediately impacts you, a lot of your competitors are probably already looking at this, and I can tell you many of them are asking about what they can do to get ahead of ESG matters. And so not planning around this and not acting around this in the coming year can put you at a competitive disadvantage if the guy in the next desk over is the one who is figuring out ways to address and deal with this.
That's a really good point, John. But before we move on, I just have one additional prediction. I predict with CREFC, the annual conference in Miami in January. The January conference is always a fairly good predictor of what to look for in the coming year. And one of the first panels is actually called Economic Fortune Telling. So I'm looking forward to seeing if any of our predictions line up with what they say at CREFC. I'm also really excited to meet Shaquille O'Neal.
Well, if any of the topics of these panels are a harbinger of things to come, I'm a bit worried given that they focus on converting distressed assets into other property types and rising insurance costs and operating expenses and managing securitization workouts. But I am definitely planning to attend the conference and our colleague Matt Fisher's panel called If We Build It, Will They Come? And Can They Afford It? Discussing multifamily properties and referencing the greatest movie of all time, Field of Dreams. But hopefully I will see some of you guys there as well.
I predict that the whole Dechert For Real team is going to be there. And while we are in Miami, we would definitely love to meet our listeners and hear from you about any new show ideas, or if you want to maybe try out to be a guest on the show. And so when we're not attending panels, you can find us at the Dechert Cabana, and you should definitely check us out at the Dechert Cocktail Party. Let's get to our For Real high fives. My high five has got to go to the Charlotte office at Dechert. They won the finance and real estate costume contest at the firm. It was a really impressive entry that they did. One of the associates in Charlotte, Evan Reed, used AI to write a like 2-minute song on Dechert, which he then paid someone to write music to and record a song to, which I thought was amazing. John Timperio, who's the co-head of the practice group at Dechert, he was dressed as Elvis. Producer Stuart McQueen had this great Don Johnson Miami Vice look going on, and Ella's 4 costume changes were striking. So high five to the Charlotte office and everybody who made that possible.
Actually, John, you can't forget Jacob Kimmel, who does production support for our podcast, because I used my connection to him, knowing him from the podcast, to convince him to help the Charlotte office make this video into a high quality production. And that's really how we won. It's all Jacob Kimmel's help that pushed us over the finish line there.
I was wondering why that video looked so professionally done. Thank you for sharing your secret. Philly's going to use that next year. I think our second year associates put together our slideshow and video, and I thought they did a great job. But obviously, you guys had Jake on your side. That's amazing.
You can't just delegate. You really have to know who to delegate to.
But I am going to have to look into the rules, because this seems to me like when you're a kid in school having your mom or your dad complete your science project for you. You look to someone outside of the Charlotte office for assistance, which, well, we'll see if we can protest this.
What I'm hearing is that Philly should have won. Thanks, Sam. I really appreciate your support in costume contest gate.
No, we'll take our high five. Thank you.
Well, we should also take time to thank John Ludwig-Eagan for coming back to discuss the SEC's revisions to final rule 192 on very short notice. And I would say look out for that on point, which I understand is very detailed, but very well done and gets into the substance there. So,
and I have a high five. I'd actually been having dinner with a team from Barings and heard that they start each of their Monday morning meetings with a dad joke, which I thought was a great idea. So I want to give them a high five for that.
That does sound fun. Send your thoughts on this episode to us at forrealpodcast@dechert.com. If this episode inspired you to think of your own dad joke, then give us a 5-star rating and leave a review with that dad joke on whatever platform you found this on. Maybe we'll read the best/worst one on the air in the future. Also, if you're attending the CREFC annual conference in Miami, please stop by our Dechert Cabana to talk to the Dechert For Real podcast hosts. Or maybe you'll spot us across the street at the Liquor Lounge after the festivities are closed for the day. This episode was hosted by Sam Gilbert, Ella Smith, and me, Jon Gaynor, with special guest John Ludwig-Eagan. It was produced by Stuart McQueen, Matt Armstrong, and Kate Mylod. Production support is by Kara Ray, Mallory Gorm, Alyssa Norton, Peggy Hefner, Lisa Caramelango, and Jacob Kimmel. Our editor is Andy Robbins of Audiophile Solutions. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time on the Dechert For Real podcast.
Hey, wait, guys. I think we should actually do a dad joke at the end of each episode.
All right, Ella, do you have a dad joke?
Of course I do. Where are all the dad jokes stored? In a database.
Oh, gosh. We are going to have another new segment here.